In this video, we'll fix a leaking four-wheel drive shift motor gasket, we'll look at unique features of the floating front calipers of the Dodge Ram, and we'll highlight functional details that make working on cars more rewarding. I hope you come along.
Good morning, guys. Well, while we're waiting for front pads and rotors on our 1998 Dodge Ram, I'm going to do a job that I've been procrastinating for the last year. I'll take you under here. The issue that I've noticed is that we've got a persistent leak of gear oil from our vacuum actuated shift motor for the front wheel four-wheel drive housing. Now you can see that that's the cover for the shift motor there. This is a vent tube right here. These are the vacuum tubes that go back to the transmission, and then this is a sensor that tells the electronics what position the shift motor is in. This vacuum actuated motor is responsible for locking the front wheels together in four wheel low, and there's a little fork and gear in there that you've seen me work on in the past. Now we've got an issue with the cover in this, and I've been contemplating the decision as to whether to simply replace the cover, and you can replace it, or whether to try and fix it in some way. First step, let's get the cover off. There's our failed seal right there. Now you can see the shift fork right here, and the shift fork hooks up to that little nut right there that ties the two, the intermediate shaft and the axle shaft, together to lock the thing in place and to unlock it. So now let's just take some of this stuff off here. This thing comes off. Electrical connector we can take off. There we go. Put that out of the way. Got the vent tube free up top, and as far as these vacuum tubes go, it looks like there's little pinch connectors here, so I'll just work on loosening these babies off. Okay, the red one goes to this side, black to this other side. Better not get those two mixed up. That's the one. There's the other. Okay, let's get it onto the bench. So you can see the way this thing works. The vacuum sucks this into different positions. It looks like it's spring loaded. It pulls it back to the outside normally. And then when the vacuum is applied, it sucks that thing the other way. But you can see, this is the bottom here. You can see there's a defect right there. You see that? Some kind of manufacturing defect. And so I'm faced with the decision, do I replace this housing? Do I just put a thick rim of RTV around? Do I somehow weld it, or perhaps even glue it with some JB weld? Let's think about that. Look at that. I think it's cast aluminum. Of course, this side's going to be cast iron. See how that shift motor works. It slides this thing either way to either engage or disengage the two front axles. Okay, so let's not overthink this problem. Rather than wait for a new gasket or make a new gasket, I'm just going to use a thick layer of RTV.
Okay,
Okay, I've given it 20 minutes to set up while I was doing those brakes. Now let's slide this into place. The bad one was down. We need to make sure the shift fork lines up properly, and it is. So for these vacuum tubes, I'm just going to put a little silicone paste around the outside of the nipples, making sure not to get it on the inside, just to prevent air leaks. Don't need a lot. And don't forget to put gear oil in it.
All right, let's move on to the front brakes. The best mechanics I've seen put emphasis on two things. First, they spend more time than you'd expect making sure the connection between the wheel, the rotor, and the hub are brushed clean of rust and dirt to prevent the wheel from going on crooked. Second, the best mechanics spend a lot of time inspecting and cleaning everything that permits the caliper to float. It's easy to forget that without a lateral slide of the caliper, you don't make consistent contact with the outside pad, and you create torsional forces on the rotor that may cause warping. Of course, the slide pins are critical, but also everything the caliper and the inside pad slides against need attention to prevent binding.
Now, there are a few unusual things about these Dodge Rams. The first thing I really like is that you can actually mount it on the frame like that. You don't need to hang it. But secondly, look at this. This is the slider, and you might think that this is how it slides, but no, that's not how it works. You only have two bolts to mount the caliper, and so they need some way of holding it solid to the knuckle. And you can see right here, when it's screwed all the way in, it's used as a stop to tighten it up and tighten it no more. So the sliding all happens on the outside there. Do you see that? Now, third thing about these Dodge Rams is that, of course, it's a floating caliper. And as such, the whole caliper has to move. And in contrast with the newer models where they have stainless steel clips, all they have here is cast iron. And so you need to remember to get these two surfaces, this one here, with a file to file down the rust. Don't just polish it, but actually file it down and get it on both sides here of both the caliper and also the knuckle so that the whole floating caliper can slide when you put your foot on the brakes. These little grommets usually just pop off. You may end up having to replace them, but if they get damaged when they do this, you may as well replace them anyway because they're not long to the world. Now, I think these inside slider bushings are phenolic, so don't use a wire brush, but this fabric brush should be okay. I just want to get a lot of the old grease out. There's something else that's unusual about these Dodge Rams. Of course, this is the inside pad and the outside pad, and you can see, as usual, the inside pad is worn more dramatically. I was overdue to change this. But interestingly enough, look at this. Here's the zinger. It's on the outside pad. Now, the general rule of thumb is that if all else is equal, you want to have your zinger on the leading edge of the inside pad because that's where the wear is worst, and that's the case here. But look at this. They put the zinger on the outside, and this wasn't a mistake. The rows for this pad is asymmetric, so this is the way they designed it to happen. But it just goes to show you that you can't rely on rules of thumb. I'm not sure why they decided to set it up that way, but in any case, that's the way it is. Haha, I'm flirting with danger here. Right up above full there. And this is a last minute check. I'd like to do this. Now you have to do this before you pump up the brakes, because once the brake pads are squeezed together, it won't work. So when the vehicle comes in for service, you won't see that kind of motion. But this is a nice double check that you're getting the movement that you want to have.
Well, when you're armed with deeper insight as to how these systems work, the job is more fun and it's harder to make a mistake. Thanks for stopping by.